Matt O'Connor joins me, founder of Fathers for Justice. Good afternoon to you, Matt.
Good afternoon, Sheila.
Lawrence Fox talked about now that his situation is settled and things are calmer, he wants to campaign for changes in the law. What might those changes be, in your view?
Well, in our view, firstly, to say it's great that, that Lawrence has shone a spotlight on this very, very difficult issue. It's an issue which doesn't receive a huge amount of media attention, apart when our campaign has historically been doing kind of the sort of very high-profile protests, which is obviously Batman and Buckingham Palace and stuff like that, just to try and get people talking about this issue. Because we have secret family courts in this country where dads aren't allowed to talk about or describe what's happening to them. So the changes we want to...
Well, hang on, just on that question of secrets, yeah. You know, there are... I think you would agree, necessary guidelines around privacy and family courts for the sake of children in particular.
Well, you can't have a justice system which is unaccountable without transparency in a modern 21st century democracy. The justice system in this country is failing children, it's failing fathers, and most importantly, it's failing families. So
what degree of
dysfunctional?
Well, okay, let's attack that one then. What degree of openness would you like to see in family courts that isn't currently there?
Well, we think there's going to be total transparency of the court system, as is with the rest of our justice system. But just coming back to your earlier point, which I do want to answer, is with the principal thing we need here is a presumption of parental equality. What we campaign for is 50-50 shared parenting. And if we want women to have equality in the workplace, that also means that there must be equality for men at home. And at the moment, we've got 3 million children in this country living in fathers' homes. We've got 1 million grandparents, Sheila, who cannot see their grandchildren. This is a world of heartbreak.
Yeah.
And the outcomes to families are apocalyptic
in
terms of the father suicide epidemic, mental health crisis, teen violence, knife crime. Some of our inner city estates in London, some of the families are 80%, 90% fatherlessness, and where the local father figure is local gang leader or local drug dealer. So it's a very, very difficult situation.
How frequently do you come across, and you know, your figures don't need to be absolutely accurate, but how frequently do you come across stories where a man has taken his own life because of this?
Well, we deal with 3 to 4 suicides a month, and they are the most difficult calls we have to deal with. I should say that I've been down that path myself back in 2001 when I had access problems to see my children, and thank God, Sheila, I survived. I see my 3 boys are now 22, 20 and 12, and I'm truly blessed, frankly, to have got through
But things got that dark, did they?
Absolutely. It was. It's like a living bereavement. That's a phrase that we coined many years ago to describe the pain and abject misery it causes you. I mean, I ended up on Waterloo Bridge one night, but that's where, you know, from that pain and suffering was born Fathers for Justice. That's where the idea of climbing bridges rather than jumping off them came from. So
you've obviously got a sense of humour, Matt.
I've got a very bad sense of humour. my sense of humour is shocking, I'm afraid.
But
let me tell you, that's my way of dealing with it.
Tell me this, because I have no direct experience of this, and I haven't covered family court cases. Why does it become so difficult for that largely 50-50, you know, where people want it? Because the typical narrative is that the woman is chasing the man to get him to pay attention to his children and to live up to his fatherly duty. So why does it so often become a situation where a father very much wants 50-50 access to his children and can't get it? Typically, what's going on to make that the case?
Well, let me first say, there are several presumptions. The law treats dads in this country like sperm banks and cash points. You have a legal obligation to pay for children, but you have no right in law to see your children. So if you separate from your ex...
No right in law to see your children?
No, you have no right. And the government's position in legalese, let me quote you, because it's something I'm very familiar with, the government's position is it does not believe a legal presumption to contact would be helpful. So there's no legal right. There is no presumption of parental equality.
Do you know why?
I could be all afternoon talking about this, Sheila. Well, let me tell you, there's a lot of opposition to parental equality for fathers in government. You're better off asking. I mean, Theresa May used to support Fathers for Justice. She supported our position. She supported 50-50 shared parenting when she was shadow families minister back in 2004. So we have a litany of broken promises and commitments made to Britain's dad.
Well, she's busy doing some creative maths at the moment, I'm afraid, Matt. I don't think you'll get her attention on this.
Yeah, but exactly.
I didn't know that. I didn't know that there was a legal presumption against fathers having a right to have access to their children.
And the courts operate on what's called the child's best interest principle. So in each case, a judge in secrecy, which as you can tell is one of my bugbears, operates in secrecy, decides what the child's best interest is. Now what that means in terms of stats and figures, 97% of residencies are given to mothers. That means that 97% of fathers who apply to see their children are unfit in the care of their children.
Well, just be clear, correct me if I'm wrong, when the Children Act came out and was revised, we moved away from the word custody to the word you've just used, residency.
Residency, correct.
And the idea is that there is an agreement between the parents as to where the child will largely reside, but that shouldn't bear any relation to whether or not the man sees his child. Because it's not custody, it's about your address.
But the reality is the working family justice system are wholly dysfunctional and not fit for purpose. They are cruel, abusive, they are driving people to their deaths, particularly fathers, and families have been utterly destroyed. It's like legalised case fighting.
But what is going on? I mean, I'm sorry to ask such a naive question, but if you divorce and the mother has the child in 22 Inkerman Street, that's the main residency of the child, and a father goes to a court, has a perfectly sensible record as a human being, isn't abusive to the child, and says, I would like regular shared access to my child, and can we agree some ground rules for that, please? Why isn't the answer to that, okay, then let's do it?
Well, you need to ask the judge.
I need you to tell me why it happens so often that it isn't the case.
Let me tell you why it is, because the court operates the child's best interest principle. Every father who goes to court is presumed to be a risk to his child. He has to go through safeguarding checks.
Really?
He is literally treated like a criminal. Let me tell you, I've got my...
Do the mothers have to go through safeguarding checks?
No. A mum can bring back the next Roy Whiting, next Ian Huntley, next Peter Sutcliffe. Nobody bats an eyelid. It is the father who is risk assessing. Yet statistically, it is the father who is the safest place for the child to be. This is the paradox. This is the grotesque injustice of this court system. My wife runs Fathers Justice, Nadine O'Connor. She's in court, literally four times this week with cases where we've got great, loving dads fighting to see their children, who want to be loving, responsible parents, yet dads are demonised, they're denigrated, they're called deadbeats for cheap political capital. I mean,
cheap political capital isn't going to stop a judge from giving Mr. A access to his children. Who's using it?
Huge discrimination. It's huge.
Are the wives using it? Are the ex-wives telling lies about their husbands?
But Sheila, these are Jurassic judges with prehistoric courts, with Stone Age thinking about the roles of men and women and mothers and fathers. And what we need is a collective solution. As we've got a Fathers for Justice, fathers, mothers, sisters, brothers, coming together, grandparents, with the great thing with grandparents outside Parliament last week, people, families coming together to try and find a responsible solution. Because shared parenting, let me tell you, in 20 US states now have a presumption of shared parenting. In Sweden, where in the 1980s, shared parenting, less than 4% separated parents shared in the care of the children. That figure is now 40%. It's responsible parenting, better outcomes for children, for our families, for our country. And I am so frustrated. I've been doing this job for 17 long years, trying to change the law to introduce this completely common sense.
Right. Whenever I cover this, that inevitably a woman rings as well as the men ringing. I can see ringing now and says, "I'd love my ex to come and see our children every other weekend and to share the load, but he's become so unreliable about timings and whether he shows up or not that my child is devastated. So I've now said no more. End of because of the emotional cruelty of not being reliable. Do you accept that exists as well?"
Well, listen, we're good mums, they're bad mums. They're good dads, bad dads. All right? But the law you know, relationships are never black and white, but the law's got to be black and white. And if you had a presumption, legal presumption of 50-50 share of parenting, let me tell you, it is our view that 90% of cases in the family justice system would disappear overnight.
That should be your starting point. 50-50, a presumption of 50-50 shared parenting. Is Matt right? 0345, I think he is. 0345, on that issue, absolutely. I know that each individual case will have its shades of, but I simply can't see how women can expect to have to want equality. Of course, we want equality, but and then for there to be such a different attitude to a father's rights to see his children, that cannot stand, can it, in a society?